Good morning, student. Continuing the chapter, public, private, and global enterprises. Let us talk about role of public sector after 1991. That is, since 1991, basically, we'll talk about that. So, what was happening initially? There are a lot of important sectors which had to be developed after independence, which we had discussed in last class. After that, despite of a lot of things which were done by public sector, these enterprises suffered several problems, and there were some shortcomings and limitations like poor project planning, excessive overheads, then overstaffing was the problem. Then also underutilization of production capacity, then lack of proper pricing policy, inefficient management, low return on investment, and then even losses. So till 1990, things were okay. They were trying to manage, but after that, they had to restructure. You know, I was telling you, it was changing. The role of public sector changed. So now the major changes which happened in 1991, let us check about those changes. So these are the reforms which were brought, and the main basis of these reforms were liberalization, privatization, and globalization. You must have done this in economics as well. So of course, business and economics are interrelated. Yes. So let us see how these policies affected the business scenario as well. Then what were the reforms brought in? Restructuring and revival of potentially viable PSUs. You know, the PSUs, public sector companies or the units which were not doing really well and they were making losses, and a unit was, they had to be revived. So those who were making losses and were not doing well, if some certain policies were brought in to revive those so that they start making profit again or they start working in line. Or those which were not revived were closed down, were shut down. And then third is bring down government's equity in all non-strategic PSUs to 26% or lower if necessary. That means earlier public sector had hold on almost everything, okay? But now they said, okay, to bring in the competition, they wanted to reduce the investment, public sector investment, okay? And then fully protect the interest of workers. That also was the reform which was brought in. Now let us talk about this in detail. New industrial policy in 1991, the first thing is reduction in the number of industries reserved for public sector from 17 to 8 and then to 3. That means minimum role of public sector in industries wherein it is not required much, right? In 1991, only 8 industries were reserved for public sector, and they were restricted to atomic energy, arms, communication, mining, railways. And then further in 2001, only 3 industries were reserved exclusively for public sector. That is, again, atomic energy, arms, and rail transport. Rest of the sectors were left open for the private players to come in or to invest. This meant that private sector could enter these areas, okay, and the public sector would have to compete with them. Right. Whenever there's a competition, both the parties try to perform better. Right. So this is what the first reform was. Now, talking about disinvestment of shares, what is the meaning of disinvestment? As I told you, in any government company, 51% minimum 51% shares should be of government. Right. Those shares are for the government. But now, if this government starts selling these shares to the private sector people, it is disinvestment. That means in What it involves? The sale of equity shares to the private sector and the general public, right? The objective was what? To raise resources, encourage wider participation of the general public and workers in the ownership of these enterprises. So basically, making the economy more liberal and moving towards privatization. The government had taken a decision to withdraw the industrial sector and reduce its equity in all undertakings. And why this would lead to improving managerial performance. You know, in government companies, people tend to, they say their job security, people tend to show laid back attitude wherein they don't want to work as, because there is no sword on their necks that if they don't perform, they will be thrown out of the job. All these things were not there, you know, the work pressure. So people were taking it very easy and there was lack of discipline. And for all these things, privatization was the solution given. And but there's a lot to be done in this area still. Assuming this would lead to improving managerial performance and ensuring financial discipline. But there remains a lot to be done in this area, as I told you. Still, many sectors are there which have to be disinvested and government is playing a role. If you check the status here, the stats, what it is showing under NDA government, it was 47% disinvestment plan was successful. Under UPA government, it was 70%, and at present they're showing it was 91%. So government is continuously in process of disinvestment so that they can use these funds for welfare projects. The same money can be invested there. And whenever disinvestment happens and there more more competition in the economy, it always helps us as the consumer or the end user, right? Let me give an example of communication sector. Initially, we had only, you know, these MTNL phones and BSNL landline phones. And that too, whenever somebody wanted a phone in their house, they had to wait for months to, you know, get it. You can check with your parents about this, how much time it took to get first phone in the house, you know, when they were small or young. So then that point, so what happened? Because of privatization, they allowed other players. Now we have Airtel, we have Geo phones, then we have Vodafone. There's so many phones are available, and the communication sector was hugely, you know, has changed, and it has helped whom? Us, the end users. Now we pay less. Companies treat us like king because we are the customers. They want more customers so that revenue per user goes up. Okay. So this is the benefit of privatization. Now, objective is more, I'll just cover this also. Realizing the large amount of public resources locked up in non-strategic PSEs so that they may be utilized for other social priority areas. You know, giving basic health facility, family welfare, primary education, all this needs money, right? And government can utilize that money in these sectors. Reducing the huge amount of public debt and interest burden. Of course, the debt will also be, when they sell shares, they'll get money. So if there is any debt, that can also be removed. Now, transferring the commercial risk to the private sector so that funds are invested in able projects. Now, risk is getting transferred. So again, they have more funds to transfer to utilize in abled projects. Now, freeing these enterprises from government control and introduction of corporate governance. Corporate governance means here more, you know, how the private sector works. They basically work on the, you know, a lot of professionalism is followed there. Let me put it as there, wherein people are accountable for the work they do, right? If they're not performing, they are answerable, they are accountable. So that kind of culture was brought in. It helped bringing in that kind of culture. So in many areas where the public sector had a monopoly, or for example, telecom sector, I've already told you, consumer have the benefit of more choices, low prices, and better quality of products and services. So these were the objectives of privatization. Now talking about policy regarding sick units. Sick units means those units which are not doing well. They are, you know, they are the burden to the government. They're loss-making units, right? So all public sector units were referred to BIFR. The full form is Board of Industrial and Financial Reconstruction. And this government agency used to decide whether the sick unit needs to be restructured or it should be closed down, right? Whether it can be revived or it has to be shut down. Now, there's a lot of resentment among workers. Suppose somebody is working for X company and that company is not doing well, and then the government wants to shut down. So what will happen? Those people, the work people working there, the employees will lose their job. Now, because of this, there was a lot of resentment among the workers. And to support them, a national renewal fund was set up by the government to retrain or redeploy these retrenched labor in some other industrial to provide compensation to public sector employees seeking voluntary retirement. What is voluntary retirement? Wherein people, like maybe when they are in 50s nearing retirement age, they were offered some lump sum money so that they can take voluntary retirement, right? So this was policy regarding sick units. Now, Memorandum of Understanding. You have covered this Memorandum of Understanding, what it is, in last class, in last chapter. Now, improvement of performance through a MOU means two parties will be there. When any MOU is signed, there will be two parties or three parties who will get affected because of this MOU, right? So, system by which managements are to be granted greater autonomy, but held accountable for specified results, wherein, you know, government companies were signing, or public sector companies were signing MOUs with the private sector, wherein private sector were given greater autonomy, wherein they can take decisions in that company without any interference from the government side. So under this system, public sector units were given clear targets and operational autonomy for achieving those targets. Okay, the target, these are the targets, and we are giving you independence to operate it, but you need to show the results. So this is what MOU was for. So between the particular public sector unit and their administrative ministries defining their relationship and autonomy, like railways is under railway ministry. But the way, you know, it changed when Mr. Lalu Prasad Yadav was railway minister, after that, you know, the changes which were brought, and of course he followed, he gave autonomy to the people, those who were running this railways. But yes, the results were phenomenal. And even he was called to one of the B schools in US to deliver a lecture stating how loss-making railways in India, how it got changed to a profit-making avenue. So this is what MOUs are. I hope you have understood. Now, talking about e-portfolio, see, whatever extra work I tell you to do, that you need to maintain it as an e-portfolio. You can make one folder wherein you can keep saving your work other than what you are doing in your notebook. Okay, I keep telling you to research or to find out, to make a digital scrapbook. A lot of work I have given you. So this work, you should be saving it in e-portfolio, and anytime we will be asking you to submit it, right? So kindly do not leave those things. If you have not done it, start doing it and keep saving it and be regular, okay? Now for today, you'll find out at least five public sector companies which are being privatized after 1991. Okay, find out about it. You can just write the company's name and when it was privatized, all those details. You can do it in PPT or something, right? Or maybe a single sheet of Word file will also do, right? At least, also you will at least list five companies which are being approved for disinvestment by government recently, which has not been yet disinvested, but yes, government has decided, yes, these companies are there for disinvestment. Okay, so five such companies, there are 23, I'm telling you to find out about only five. Okay, so do this work and stay safe till we meet next. Thank you.